Good evening and welcome to the last quarterfinal, the game between Australia and Great Britain. The referees
from Canada, Ryan Gordon, and from Canada also Kevin Bowie. Game commissioner from New Zealand, Donald Dinnington. Scorekeeper, Heather Williams, Great Britain. Timekeeper, Vivi Leighton, Denmark. 40-second operator, Camilla Bach, Denmark. Penalty timekeeper, Mogens Jensen, Denmark. And now to the team presentation. First, the team from Australia. Number 10 and the captain, Chris Bond. Number 1, Ella Sapiak. 2, Emily Miller. Number 3, Riley Mads. 4, Jack Hull. 5, James McKillen. 6, Michael O'Sam. 8, Ben Fokkers. 9, Richard Warris. Number 12, Shay Graham. 14, Andrew Edmondson. And number 21, Josh Nicholson. The head coach, Brad Doubley. Assistant coach, Jason Lees. And the team from Great Britain. The captain, number 4, Gavin Walker. Number 2, Jonathan Cockham. 5, Jack Smith. 7, Kylie Grimes. Number 8, Nicholas Cummings. 9, Oliver Mangion. 10, Ayaz Buta. 11, Kieran Flynn. 12, Jamie Stead. 13, Aaron Phipps. And number 24, Ryan Cowling. The head coach from Great Britain, Mr. Paul Shaw. And the assistant coach, Darren Matthews. And the referee is once again from Canada, Ryan Gauthier and Kevin Bowie. And in a minute, we are ready for the two national anthems. We are a little ahead of the time, sorry. But here we come, the national anthem of Australia.
Thank you.
anthem of Great Britain.
Hello and welcome to the nightcap of what has been an absolutely incredible day five here at the 2022 Wheelchair Rugby World Championship. It is Australia versus Great Britain in that traditional matchup that has been played out so many times in so many sports, particularly in wheelchair rugby, usually at the semi-final or the final stage. But the quality of the field here is such that they are meeting in the quarterfinals. My name's Drew Lilly. Alongside me, lucky enough to have Chris Ryan, British Paralympian gold medal winner and a former member of this squad. You're a Brit, I'm a Brit as well, but I reckon I'm going to start commentating in an Australian accent just to sort of balance things out, you know?
Opposing sides this evening.
No, we are in the commentary box, obviously, so we are going to be as impartial as Ryan Goodet and Kevin Bowie, who are the two referees who appear right on cue this evening, the two Canadians. So, yes, the Canadians knocked out a little bit earlier in an absolute classic against USA. Just looking quickly at the starting lineup, no real surprises there for Australia. The two high pointers, Batt and Bond, and then the two low pointers, Fawcett and James McQuillan. James McQuillan, who only took up the sport 11 months ago. Great Britain captain, Gavin Walker, one of the on-court generals, Kylie Grimes, and then Stead and Phipps, the dynamic duo up front, who weren't as dynamic as they could have been against USA yesterday. Seemed to struggle a little bit.
Yeah, it was a tough one for them. USA are renowned for coming out hard. And, you know, really putting you to the sword as quick as they can. And GB just didn't seem ready for it yesterday. So surely they had a chat about that game and, you know, tried to change the way that they start this one.
Now, you could see there that Riley Batt has got his left shoulder significantly strapped up there. He seemed to have some sort of impingement in the final group game that Australia ended up losing. It was a tight one to Japan, which means they ended up second in their group and meant that they faced Great Britain. He's got the names of his kids written on there. So that's something that he's going to be taking with him out there. It's definitely Aliyah, and I'm trying to think of it. I think it's Killian. So that's the names of his kids out there with a little heart on there. And he's going to play through the pain barrier. He was playing through the pain barrier yesterday, and I'm sure he's going to do that today as we have the countdown.
9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Away we go. Who's going to win the opening tip? Riley Batt, but who's going to pick it up first? Riley Batt. Who's going to hair off down the court? Riley Batt. Who's going to score the first try? Riley Batt.
Shoulder seemed okay on that first play there.
It did. It's early days, but it looked fine, didn't it? Up for the tip-off and down to get the ball off the floor. So his opposite number, Aaron Phipps.
Something that Aaron Phipps really needs to do in this game is trust his wills against these two 3.5 players. You know, he can definitely match them for speed. It's just whether he can, you know, play the overall game today. Yeah, you'll see that Aaron will be able to out-sprint Riley at times in this game. So be an interesting battle as this one progresses.
GB with the more balanced lineup.
Timeout called there from Australia early. Two kind of opposing lineups here. We got Australia with a high-low with 2 3-5s and 2.5s, and then we've got a real balanced line from GB. So, you know, if Australia will have some troubles marking that third man in Gavin Walker, number four.
Yes, GB going 3-5, 2-5, 2 and 0.5. And those of you observant thinking, well, that's 8.5 and you're only allowed 8. You are, but you have the bonus if you have a female player out there. And as you can see right in the centre of your screen now, Kylie Grimes. She allows GB to play with 8.5. Australia can do the same if they want to bring on Emily Miller. They may do. Ella Sabljak, we've hardly seen any of her, 2.5. And Shay Graham, who could well come on. Oh, how about that? Australia with the early steal.
Yeah, good defence there from Chris Bond, you know, racing with Aaron up the sideline. They kind of baited him towards... There are danger areas on the court, so anywhere just over the halfway line or in the corner, anything like that, you don't want to be as a player with the ball.
Don't want to go out of bounds.
Yeah. And the defence did a really good job there of putting him in that corner. So you see here, Gavin Walker's trying to stop Riley Back coming on. And he did fail to do so. Gavin Walker thinks that Riley broke a rule there, but nothing said.
I'm trying to work out why Riley was in the sin bin there after Australia had scored a try. Was he celebrating too overtly? Or
he does things too quickly for us to see. I think.
Exactly, yes. We can't even see when he's committing a foul. The Aussie Brench there with Dubs, Brad Doubley, the coach. Phipps races over and Riley Batt even manages to get back to his feet quickly, back to his wheels rather. And there is Brad Doubley's opposite number, Paul Shaw.
You just saw there, if Aaron had some open space, I think he was winning that race. So what Riley will try to do with Aaron is keep him in small areas, because that's the advantage Riley has over Aaron. He's a little bit more agile and a little bit quicker off the mark.
So Bat in the bin twice. He's going to inbound, and that is going to go out of bounds. No, it's not, because Chris Bond was there. The man with 215 Australian caps to his name. Make sure he doesn't do the over and back. Got to wait for his fellow high pointer to come and help him. He's worked his way into and out of trouble. And scores a try.
Fantastic chair control by Chris Bond out by that sideline when he threw it in. And then the patience to wait for Riley to come up court.
Try simplicity itself for GB. So keeping it reasonably close, and there they are, the Union Jackets. Australian fans the world over, regardless of what they're watching, tend to be known as the fanatics, starting off with the tennis. And I'm definitely going to stick with the Union Jackets. I'm just going to keep repeating it until people pick up on it, and it will work. I guarantee you it will work. Might need a bit of help. I might need you to run a few screens for me and occasionally come out with it. Ah, there they are, the Union Jackets.
Okay. So Australia keying up here, defending that key. They're only allowed 3 defensive players in that key area.
And there was, I think, the caster of one of the wheels there from Ben Fawcett just rolled over.
Just about got that rule in time before it happened.
It's perfect timing, absolutely brilliant. It's like you've got 12 seconds to get the ball over the halfway line. You've got 5 seconds before Fawcett accidentally puts his wheel in the key. Bounce it every 10 seconds, there's another rule. Over the top to the skipper, Walker. Well, the Aussies playing a bit of a rough game. They've been in and out of the penalty box.
So something you're seeing there, Gavin Walker is, we call it line trapping Chris Bond when he comes on. And they're going to have some issues. If Gav can continue to do that, they're going to have some issues because Riley's going to have to beat essentially the rest of the GB team when Chris is, you know, being played by a two-pointer. So it's something to watch out for.
Yes, if a two-pointer can keep Chris Bond hemmed in. Oh, how about that for Hans with mere seconds left, barely a second left to get the ball over the halfway line. Beautiful Hans. Yes, if Riley Batt's basically got 6.5 to contend with, then it'll be a challenge even for him.
As we can see, Gavin Walker's got Chris Bond there on the baseline.
And as you mentioned earlier, Aaron Phipps can go in a wheel race, wheel to wheel with Riley Batt. Reaching in there, was the foul called.
This will be something that Brad Dubley's thinking about, whether he gets one of the low pointers to inbound at some point. Or the other option is if Chris Bond has a better option, you know, one where he can push onto the court with a bit of speed, he might be able to move Gavin on that line trap.
GB scoring very comfortably at the moment. For Australia, it's a bit more laborious. However, the Aussies have that turnover.
GB really using that balance that they have. And as we see, the low pointer inbound straight away, just after, you know, us speaking about Chris getting line trapped.
Riley Batt there on the very limits of the court, 15 metres wide, and I think he was 14 metres and about 95 centimetres across. Phipps hemmed in but gets out a beautiful pass to Walker, who finds Stead. Well, other than the turnover, GP have looked dominant.
Yeah, they have. The way Australia will get their turnovers in this kind of a game is they'll try and isolate the ball. So if Riley can get basically on any player and they don't have a picker, that's when they'll get their stops, because he can play everyone pretty much in the world one-on-one. So they're the kind of scenarios that Australia will be trying to create.
Now, Australia have decided to go for a more balanced lineup, and if they're going to leave a high pointer in, it's invariably Riley Batt. So Brad Dubley making a few changes and bringing on two of his favoured mid-pointers, Josh Nicholson, number 21, and Andrew Edmondson, number 14. Phipps and Batt, this way and that. Phipps with all the moves. Batt still follows him every inch of the way.
Looks like Jamie's just got that timeout call in time.
Well, the timeout called because he was going to be forced. He wasn't going to get through there. He knocked the post out of the way, and the post now being put back by the ref. So timeout used by Great Britain. Australia had already used one.
20 seconds on the shot clock. They want to get this key attack runners or started as early as they can, just to give themselves as much time as possible.
It's Australia with arguably a more balanced defence there. Corralled in beautifully by Gavin Walker.
Really good pass. Good post from Gavin Walker, and good strength to push through the low pointer's pick bar. As Riley shake and bakes, and he's all on his own. Spat something out on the core there.
I think it's a bit of the tape that's holding some of the surgical, the medical tape. It's the red that's either underneath it or over the top of it. So he, since he's got a few seconds to spare, so we might as well do that. Who says men can't multitask? And Phipps loses that one, courtesy of an intervention by Nicholson, and we need an equipment timeout.
That's really unfortunate there from Aaron Phipps. He got here just as he was bouncing the ball. You know, that is a skill to be able to bounce the ball at the right time. You try and do it when you're in a little bit of clear air. You know you're going to have some more battles coming down the way and you want a fresh 10 seconds.
Bounced the ball. Yes, indeed, it wasn't Nicholson, other than Nicholson's close proximity to him. Forward to Edmondson, the New South Wales connection. Edmondson's going to look to give it back to bat. Back to bat being an AC/DC song. And over he goes. I forget that people who don't live in Australia don't know every AC/DC song by heart. I'm not a particular fan, and I just got in trouble with a load of Australian viewers there, but you hear AC/DC all the time. It's just sort of always on in the background, regardless. Pipe it through shopping malls, and it's always there.
I think I'd struggle to give you one song name by them.
Back in Black. No. Thunderstruck.
I reckon I'd recognise them.
You would if they played them. I'm not going to hum them. I need to protect my voice. So we are down into the money time. It's in the last 2 minutes. This is the time when I invariably start asking you, Chris, about the timestamps and when teams want to score, how much time they want to take off the clock, how much time they want to, or how little time they want to leave their opponents. But the main thing to do in money time is to not turn the ball over.
Yeah, so I'll just run through a few of the timestamps the teams will be looking for. Australia scored on 1 minute 37, well, the try before this one that you're seeing on the replay. They scored on 1 minute 37, and that allows them to then control their next offensive set, and they will try and score between 50 and 55 seconds. All of this is to try and create kind of like a 2-for-1 at the end of each quarter.
Making sure that you have possession, run down the clock, and then leave as little time as possible for your opponents. Well, a coach's timeout has been called by the GB coach, Paul Shaw.
Riley Batts made such a strong start to this game.
That shoulder's looking fine, isn't it?
It is. That's something you need to really avoid if you're playing them. You need to get through that first 5-6 minutes or the first quarter and start frustrating him. You know, you give him an inch and he'll take a mile. You've got to get that almost like playing a away game in football at home. You know, you'll try and keep the ball, make the game slow, get the home crowd frustrated and take them out of it. That's kind of what you want to do with Riley, but easier said than done, it looks like.
Yes, try and get him frustrated early. He's always been quite an emotional player. He's an emotional kid, definitely. And made his Olympic, Paralympic debut 18 years ago as a 15-year-old. 324 caps for Australia and counting. He's going to get 500 easily. So, timestamp. I do believe 55 is your magic number, anywhere between 52 and 55. Should we have that halfway between 52 and 55? Absolutely perfectly. So that means even if the opposition try to run 40 seconds off the clock in scoring, you're going to have 14 or 15 seconds left in which to score yourselves. Priority here for Great Britain, though, is to score.
Now Australia have the whole shot clock to score their goal. There's some trouble here getting the ball in, though.
10 seconds of which to inbound, and Edmo to Riley, the New South Wales Gladiators. Josh Nicholson, the Queenslander.
Oh, turnover.
Wow, well, that was a spinning foul by Nicholson, so there it was, magnanimously talking about the Queenslander, and then he goes and commits a foul, which is going to give GB 32 seconds in which to reduce that deficit.
Yeah, that would really frustrate the Australian coach. Absolutely no need.
No, he just went straight for him and got him behind the axle, which means you can obviously hit, but it's got to be, it can't be behind the axle. So 28 seconds to go. There's no possession clock because it's the same as the game clock. And Phipps looking up there on the cube to see how long he's got left.
Be a great momentum shift for
it would be huge.
GB if they can score this.
Have to score it first, though, and Edmo. Well, here's a momentum shift. Oh, could have gone one way, goes the other. Well, I can sing the praises of the New South Wales connection once again. Andrew Edmondson getting the hands in there. Riley Batt picking it up. GB decide not to risk any more mistakes, and well, that was a huge swing at the end. It could have been 15-13. It ends up being 16-12.
One thing you're seeing from the two key attacks that I've seen in that quarter, the ball's traveling a long way in the air, and that gives the guys in the key a lot longer to react. So say that ball's traveling from the other side, like we saw that pass from Aaron there. You know, it gave Andrew Edmondson a few seconds to read that ball, pull back and make the interception. So that'll be something that they'll try and tighten up, maybe make the passes, you know, shorter 2 or 3 metre passes rather than, you know, going across the half of the court.
Ollie Mannion we're seeing there from the London club. And he may well be featuring at some point in the second quarter. Now, you might be wondering why we're not hearing what the coaches are saying. It's, I know some of you may have seen a few videos going around after the first quarter yesterday, where there were a few choice words that I had to speak over when Paul Shaw was getting rather animated. But it's primarily to make sure that we're not divulging tactics. It's a great shame that you at home don't get to hear the ins and outs of the great coaching minds, but we can't have them being stolen by opposition teams. So we missed the statistics there while I was chatting away. So the main thing is 4 turnovers as opposed to 1. 1 turnover, Australia, 4 GB.
Yeah, and a really solid start there from Australia. You know, that one turnover was also a really unnecessary one for them. So if they can continue to play in which they are and just control their minds, really. I think that was a mind blank there, turnover. So, you know, that's the kind of little things that they'll be trying to sort out. GB just need to continue to space the floor against Australia.
Riley Batt picking up those loose balls. He's also got 12 tries to his name, 4 to Chris Bond. GB, it's 5 for Jamie Stead, 4 for Aaron Phipps, and 3 for Gavin Walker, spread around on the more balanced lineup.
Always felt like it was a game of chess against Australia when I used to play them.
I was going to ask you must have had some battles against them in your time.
Particularly against their high-low lineup. I remember a game at the Worlds last time, 4 years ago, and it was a game with only 3 turnovers in it for both teams in combined. We gave away 2 and they gave away 1. And it was crazy. No one could get a stop. But it was a really tight game. You just got to keep the ball away from Riley and then, you know, try and make Chris Bond defend such a huge space. So, but obviously they've got a little bit more depth at this tournament. They've been running the 2-2s lineup.
Well, now we've seen a few changes. Shea Graham is out there. And Mick Ozan has come on. So Shea Graham being there, 2.5er. That enables Australia to play 8.5. Two changes as well for GB. Jack Smith is out there and getting involved at the moment. Ollie Mannion has indeed come on for Aaron Phipps. Shea Graham, the Darwin librarian. I'm contractually obliged to call her that every time.
You can put quite a bit of pressure on here, GB. It's good defense.
Over the top to Shea. 35-year-old, made her debut in 2019. Played at the Paralympics last year. When Australia were caught cold, they lost to Denmark in the opening match. Surprise to everyone. But I think COVID really affected Australia, such a huge country. And when you've got someone like Shea Graham from Darwin who has played for Victoria Thunder, so that's the opposite side of the continent. You imagine how difficult it is to get together for training sessions when it's such a huge country that is a continent all in one. Graham pops it over the top to bat.
Yeah, it was a bit of a shame for them in Tokyo. They only took 2 0.5 players with them, and obviously they need two for their high-low lineup. One of them was ill. I don't know exactly what happened, but they were basically unable to run the lineup for the whole week. You know, and I think it's the first time that happened to them. They're having that injury or having the illness, and then at this tournament they've brought four with them. So, you know, maybe learn from that mistake and realise how important that line is to them.
They have indeed. One of those point fivers is, ball comes loose, but it is still going to be a GB ball. You can see the referees point in the direction of attack of the team that's going to get the ball. James McQuillan, 28-year-old former Aussie Rules player who broke his back during an Aussie Rules match, only been playing. He watched the Tokyo Paralympics. He would have seen you getting a gold medal, Chris, and decided that he might take up that sport because it looked quite interesting. And here he is a year later playing at the Worlds.
Really is impressive that he started the game today, and after 11 months, that's some achievement.
Yes, he's had experimental nerve surgery on moving nerves so that they could. Certain nerves were working, others weren't, and three lots of surgery to have certain muscles connected up to use more useful muscles for him and make the most of the nerves that were working. It's a great article that was in the Guardian yesterday, and well worth a read if anyone hasn't seen it. And fascinating stuff. Stead weaves his way through.
Really good play by him there, and he's the couple of key attacks we've seen lately with him running the ball have looked really good. One of them went to Jack, and then I think one went to Gavin Walker. But you know, the ball was in the air for a lot shorter period of time, and just looked a lot more solid.
Edmondson to bat. You can see the possession clock ticking down to around 20. Riley, are you going to get out of the way? No, you're not. Well, I'd better pop it in your lap then. Great presence of mind there from Riley Batt.
Lovely play from GB there. Exactly what they got to do. Make Riley feel like he's chasing shadows. If he can't get one-on-one with people, they're going to struggle. Australia have some subs getting ready to come in. They've got Chris Bond, a one-pointer, and...
Well, they've got Jake Howe, and I presume it's going to be Emily Miller.
So they'll be running with an 8.5 lineup,
yes,
when they come,
yes,
on.
Yes, so it must be Emily Miller who's coming on to enable them to play Jake Howe, the one-pointer, as well as the 2 3-5s. Riley getting in there, and I think he knows where he's going.
Jamie did really well there. He passed, He got past the ball and then he was keeping it away from Riley as he was crossing the half.
And then Riley just got a bit frustrated and he's not one of his contact lenses out there.
Jamie's got to shrug that one off. He's had a really good couple of minutes.
GB taking their time so they can set up a trap in front of Riley Batt. And Riley says, OK, would you mind if I inbound? Sir, asking the referee.
So he'll be looking for Chris here, but he's got a hard double on him. Oh, what a catch.
That was.
So Riley's not actually on the court. I don't quite know why the ref's not allowing him to come on.
Timeout being called, and I think Riley is pointing out what you've just pointed out as well, Chris. So Australia down to two timeouts, but still 3 points to the good and with possession.
It's something Australia are going to have to be really careful of. Is that line trap. The easier the option is for the person to pass to, the more speed the inbounder can come on with, because they're not having to worry about the pass so much. And that will allow them to get by Gav, but because the options aren't good, they're getting line trapped.
And that was an excellent block from Jake Howe, the Perth enforcer. Well, he's going to take his time. When you're 3 points clear and it's about to be four, then you might as well run some time off the clock. So we have indeed had Howe, Miller and Bond coming on. Australia playing 3-5, 3-5, 1.5. Riley Batt racing over there and making it personal with Jamie Stead. Bond following him now. Down to about 20 on the possession clock.
Really intense defense there from Australia. Chibi kind of got themselves into that hole because it looked like there was the opportunity for the fast key attack. But that's one thing you don't want to do with Australia is run and gun. So Jack Smith did get the timeout call in time. And that's, you know, smart to use them, you know, keep that score as close as possible.
Crucial for GB to score with this possession though. And got 18 seconds in which to do it. Bond bashing away Stead. Tries to work his way through and pops it over the top to Ollie Mannion.
Really great draw and pass there from Jamie Stead.
Ideal use of the timeout. Mannion keeping pace with Bond, as is Stead. Riley Batt's going to have to come up at some point. There he is, his tiniest of handoffs.
Interesting watching Riley there. He inbounded the ball, got line trapped, and he watched to see if Chris Bond was going to score the easy goal so he didn't have to put the effort in. He got chased down and he was like, oh, gotta beat the line trap.
Mannion needs to get the ball out over the halfway line and can't. So that's two timeouts in a row being used by GB. They're down to just the one left. They've made good use of them thus far. If you can score a point after it, then the timeout has served its purpose. What's your record against Australia off the top of your head? Can you remember? You tend to win more than you lost, or?
Definitely lost more.
Yeah.
You know, the team that I was part of had to go on a long journey over 8 years. And, you know, these guys were almost as good as they are now back then.
It's amazing to see them now ranked at number four in the world.
Yeah, that's not representative. That was, you know, them having injuries and illnesses and things like that. So you'd be a fool to treat these guys like number four in the world now.
Yes, this is number two in the world against number four in the world. And a beautiful pass there to a one-pointer. Howe rolls onto that one.
Yeah, going back to your question, I don't know the record, but it wouldn't be great reading from GB's point of view.
Ball tossed away, and there's a few high fives there from the Australian players, and also between Riley Batt and Jamie Stead.
Saw the coach there pointing to the timeout that was on the cube. You know, obviously the coach wanting to use those timeouts to keep the score as close as possible.
You want one left for the second half, you'd have thought. Going into the second half with no timeouts is you're leaving yourself rather empty-handed. Oh, we could almost see the tactics board there being not quite hidden by Jason Lees, the assistant coach. Maybe we can have a sneaky look at that. Maybe you can pop down there and pass a few words of wisdom on. We can roll down there and we'll get you a roving microphone at half time, and you can just say you're a commentator, which you are, of course, and go and steal some inside information from Brad Dooley and Jason Lees. The Aussies with a 5-try lead at the moment. It's going to go down to 4. This is a bit of crash and bash between Bond and Mannion.
Good help there from Ollie, getting the hit in on Chris Bond.
The passing between Bond and Batt is really something to behold, isn't it? It's that time of the quarter again when players like Riley Batt start looking at the time cube.
It should really be a good matchup for GB when Gavin Walker gets that line trap, because, you know, the other guys should have a good chance to defend Riley kind of three on three, but with so much of a point kind of deficit, if you like. But they're not really able to stop him at all. He's like a get out of jail free card, but they've got that card on every offensive sequence.
Stead needs to get rid. Here. Still got the timeouts, as his coach reminded him a couple of minutes ago. Doesn't need it. Gets out of jail all on his own. And goes coast to coast.
He's done fantastically there, Jamie.
He's a good player. He's a great 2-5, isn't he, Jamie Stead? He really is.
He is.
About the best 2-5s of the tournament, you think of someone like Cam Leslie, who started as a 3 for New Zealand and was reclassified as a 2-5. Jamie Stead, every bit as good as him as a 2-5.
Yeah, Josh Wheeler's always up there as well for those awards.
Yes, Josh Wheeler. It was Josh O'Neill, actually, who got the player of the match in the USA-Canada quarterfinal today. And then the winner of this quarterfinal will face the host nation, Denmark, who overcame France. The amazing thing was Denmark fourth in their group defeated France first in theirs in the crossover. That's the beauty of the quarterfinals here. Quarterfinals introduced this year. It used to be straight to the semis, so only the top two got through. So, whoa!
Ollie Mannion there with a big hit on Chris Bond.
And a big and illegal hit.
Yes, it was a legal hit. I don't think Chris was expecting that. He's probably never played he's probably never played against Ollie. I think no. Ollie made his debut against Australia in the Canada Cup.
The Cup, yep.
And you know, when you don't see players a lot, you don't quite know how they hit, how strong they are on their chairs.
Where have you come from? And yes, oh right, oh right, I'll have to watch out for you in future. So yes, that hit was legal, and that meant that Chris Bond took the ball to the floor, so it's a turnover. Once again, GB getting a turnover with around 30 seconds to go. Last time they couldn't make the most of it. This time, I'm pretty sure their coach will be rather angry if they don't capitalise and get the point. That's a skidding in there. Phipps gets it away, and it's happened again. How is it happening every time in the last 30 seconds? Getting the turnover and then handing it straight back.
Yeah, it's just a miscommunication there. Aaron's obviously pinned by the side of the key, and he tries to pass it to Gavin. But yeah, it just looks like GB are struggling to attack Australia's key, especially with this lineup that GB have on. I wonder if maybe Jamie ran the ball, because he's, you know, he can pass the ball really well, and Aaron's probably a better post. You know, he's a bit taller, strong.
Aussies with a more balanced lineup, but a more balanced lineup that every lineup they have includes Riley Batt, except when he's injured, as was the case in the match against Japan. And as happened at the end of the first quarter, GB get a turnover. GB can't capitalise and give it back. Riley Batt scores a try now. Can GB get it over the line in the next second or so? And the answer is no. So we come to the end of the first half. Australia leading 29-24. That's two quarters in a row that they've won. The first was 16-12. This one was a lot closer, 13-12. But they're still pulling away, as you can see on the screen there. Two timeouts to one. It's all going the way of the Aussies at the moment.
Yeah, we just saw Jamie pushing back to the bench there with his head down. He looks, I don't know if he's hurt or...
Just his pride.
Yeah. I mean, he's had a really good game, though, Jamie, particularly in that second quarter. He's really got to keep his head up, you know, kind of inspire his guys. If they can follow his lead, you know, they'll be in a really good position. But
far easier time of it for those in green and gold. Everyone looking far more calm. Andrew Edmondson taking on a banana. It's easy to be calmer when you've got that man there. I think the worry for Australia was that Riley Batt was going to be injured. He missed a good... Well, he was injured at the end of the second quarter against Japan and had a lot of work on it over the big break, the 10-minute break, and then came back later in the third quarter, but it was too late to change it around against Japan. But he certainly looks to be showing no ill effects of all that strapping he has on his shoulder.
It looked to be a muscle injury, didn't it, from what the physio was?
Yes, he was getting a lot of manip. As we have a quick look at the stats, 2 turnovers to 1. GB running the screens very well, but it's still the fact that there are 2 turnovers from Great Britain. That one turnover right at the end after they'd forced a turnover out of Australia, and then giving the ball right back was a real shame. Now, as you can see, the other stat you can see is the top of the cube there that says 7 minutes and 55 seconds to go. And that's the long halftime break. So you can watch some highlights during those 7 or 8 minutes. We're going to have a quick break and we will be back for the second half. Welcome back. Here is the Team GB huddle. Don't worry, those of you who don't like fruity language, they're not mic'd up this time. I'm not going to have to talk over them and spare anybody's blushes. Team GB during half-time were running a few training drills, maybe just trying to get back into a rhythm. They find themselves 5 tries adrift at half-time. There we go, you can see the cube perfectly. Australia 29, Great Britain 24. Australia with 2 yellow discs, so that's 2 timeouts that the players can still call if they look like they're going out of bounds or need to reset the shot clock. Great Britain just with 1. I've got Chris Ryan who, alongside me, who won gold a year ago with Team GB. You're not there to help them turn it around. Can they turn it around? Of course they can.
Yeah, I mean, you know, anything's possible, but if Australia play like they did in that first half, it's going to be really tough. They've given 1 turnover away in each quarter.
And they got it straight back.
Yeah. And if they continue that, 4 turnovers in a game will generally win them a game. So, GB have got to find a way to do a little bit more on defence, because obviously they've got to get some back. And more importantly, scoring every goal that they can. Just got to keep moving that ball.
They're going to need to play perfect rugby.
Got a slightly different lineup on here, GB. They've got 3-2-5-2-5.5, and they're playing with 8.5 points. So 3 really functional guys on the court, and they'll really be looking to move that ball.
Ayaz Butter has come on. Kylie Grimes is the 0.5, and she allows them to play an extra 0.5. Shea Graham with the initial inbound is on, as is Andrew Edmondson. So a couple of 2.5s. And it's Riley Badd, of course, because Riley's going to be on, as he always is. And then Ben Fawcett. 3-5-2-5-2.5. Riley Badd working his way out.
Impressive the way he was able to push through that double team there. He's able to push and protect the ball at the same time.
That's a bit of a rough and ready inbound there from Ayaz Butter. Let's have a look at Dickie Voris and Ella Sabljak on the bench for Australia. Haven't seen a lot of game time. That was gave Ollie Mannion a little bit too much to do there. So first turnover goes the way of Australia. We were saying that GB need to play perfect rugby if they're going to get back into this. And that's not what they need. It's a 7 try deficit already.
Really good from Jamie Stead there. When he went past Riley, he just kind of pushed across him to stop Riley getting back into the play, and that allowed that pass over to Ollie Mannion there.
The mid-pointers exchanging passes. Shea Graham's gone flying forward, and Riley Batt's always going to find her. Bit of a sliding doors moment for you, but around 2 days ago, GB were leading France and should have beaten France and were 2 up with barely a minute to go if they'd have won that match. Since then, they seem to have been all out of sorts.
They have. It's been a difficult tournament for them. One of their best players is not here.
Yeah, Stuart Robinson, who was named in the squad but hasn't been able to take part.
And, you know, he's a key part for them. But, you know, even without him, they'd have expected to probably perform a little bit better than they have. But, yeah, like you say, they did play a really good game against France. And
just changed that final minute. They're in a different slot in the group, but it's the confidence they would have had.
Yeah. And that's the kind of thing that I think is lacking a little bit. If we look at like how Jamie Stead's played in the second quarter and even the start of this third, they really need to try and follow that. And you know, if 4 guys are out there playing in a calm way, you're going to be okay. You might not be rushing and everything like that, but you know, the tries will go on the board, you'll be annoying, you'll be, you know, consistent, hard to beat. And GB have just given another turnover away there. Ollie Mannion was hit out of bounds while GB were trying to score the key attack. You've got to not get yourself too close to that try line, especially with Riley around to knock you over.
Exactly. There's Buddha to Jamie Stead, and then how about that for a pass to Ollie Mannion? That's a beauty.
He does have some crazy passes in him, Ayaz. When he does it, you kind of hold your breath, but they always end up in your teammate's lap, so he knows what he's doing.
33 years old, played in 2016 and 2020 at the Paras, at the Euros, 2015, 2017, 2019. 2019 was a good year at the Euros for Team GB.
GB trying to double Riley here. And they managed to stop him.
Shay Graham is proving to be a very good outlet. Now, Ollie Mannion is always going to have a little bit of more pace than her. Now, can Riley keep it in? Yes. Can do it without using a timeout? Yes. Can he get out of a seemingly impossible labyrinth? Yes. Can he score? I think you know the answer.
Ollie Mannion just giving him a little love tap on the line there.
Well done, Jamie Stead. He just keeps on keeping on, doesn't he?
Yeah, he did really well to reach that one.
Mannion staying with bat. Back comes Buta.
Brilliant.
There in the key.
Great push there from Mannion to keep up with Riley back.
3-pointer keeping up with a 3-5. And throws the ball forward, gets it over the halfway line, gets it out of danger, gets it into the lap of Jamie Stead.
Been really impressed with Ollie Mannion this week. He might not have been expecting to get the minutes that he's got, but he really has been a shining light for GB, and you know, they'll be looking to develop him for the future.
Yes, just 26 years old. Find a way around bats. Fawcett's in there as well.
GB need to kind of reset and get a proper key attack sorted here.
The bat gets a hand to it. It's going to go out of bounds. And it went off a GB player.
Looked like Kylie Grimes tried to grab it back in, but it's just too difficult to reel in.
You're thinking, I'm pretty sure she touched it, and then you could see her, the expression on her face that gave it away. If ever there was any doubts, the referee was obviously right there, but if ever there was any doubt as to whether she touched it or not, there was not much of a poker face there.
So GB have made some subs, and they've gone with...
Kieran Flynn's come on.
He has. He's actually done really well when he's played this week, but... He hasn't really played much at all.
Yes, Kieran Flynn not featured a lot. Johnny Coggan, hardly seen anything of him.
Number two,
So expect this GB line to hopefully do well. They've got a real balanced line on 3-5, 2-2.5.
Yes, Aussies have gone for the opposite. So they've gone for the high-low once again. Quill is back on. Chris Bond barely back out and finds himself on the deck. Gavin Walker explaining a few things there to Aaron Phipps. Flynn all locked up there by two low pointers.
So this 12 seconds will have only just started when Gavin actually retrieved that ball in control. It's a rule that is quite complicated, but that 12 second count to go over the half only starts when the ball is in control. It's not on the shot clock 12, so it could. Sorry, I just thought Australia were in some trouble there, but now they're not.
They pressed the bat button.
Yes.
And they called the bat phone. Sent out the bat signal.
Got a great name for a duo, haven't they? Bat and Bond.
Choose your superhero. Do you want Bond, Chris Bond, or do you want the Batman? In like Flynn, and it's inbounded by Kieran Flynn. You've heard of Errol Flynn, haven't you, or are you too young?
No.
He was a swashbuckler. He was in 1940s. Movies tended to play the roles of the pirate before you had the likes of Johnny Depp, and he was actually from Tasmania in Australia. Every day's a school day with me. You've said it before.
I have learned something every day.
Tried to forget most of it.
I was expecting him to be a bit more recent than 1940, but
well, come on.
I didn't know they were making movies back then. But
oh, that's why they called movies. They were moving pictures. See, you're learning. Bond getting all tied up there. And oh, he gets the luck.
You actually saw Chris Bond laughing with Jack Smith there. And it was at the exact point that he laughed that Aaron got the reach.
And a giggle, the pair of them, and whoop.
And you saw his face immediately turn from laughing to serious.
Yeah,
when Aaron popped it out.
Thinking, oh, I'm in trouble here with the coach, but
it was right in front of him as well, wasn't it?
It was right in front of the bench, so there's. I think the fact that the coaches were mic'd up for the first couple of days and then people were allowed to hear things and they maybe got a little bit paranoid that secrets were going to be revealed. It's now led, there's a timeout from GB using their final timeout. It's now led to the coaches waving signs we had in the USA-Canada game. USA coach Delagrave for the coaching staff held up board that said Windex at one point, and then once they got a New York Yankees logo,
okay.
The French held up fauteuil at one point, which is a wheelchair. It literally means an armchair, but in French, a rolling armchair is what they call a wheelchair, so they held that up, and then they were holding up various numbers, and you got different colored cards from the Danes. Brad Doobley seems to be holding up different colored cards as well, so it's all secret signs now.
Mm. And they're really useful when the hall is so loud.
Well, when you're playing Denmark, and whoever wins this will play Denmark tomorrow, you're not going to be able to hear yourself think here in the Spectrum. So, yes.
Number 4, Kevin Walker.
Brilliant pick and roll there from Chris Bond. He's looked really strong this week. We didn't see him at Canada Cup.
No, it's great to have him back. He missed the Canada Cup. in May, I think it was. He missed the Australian Championships, championship in June. And it's great to have him back.
Aaron Phipps and Chris Bond going stride for stride there.
Oh, drops the shoulder and gets in between the two high pointers.
Good composure there from Phipps. Riley just hopping off that pick from Jack Smith. That's not an easy thing to do. Jack's got a great pick on him.
Yeah, might be wondering where Chris Bond is, but he has been tied up by Kieran Flynn. So Riley's going to have to do this with the help of a couple of low pointers.
So Riley will be looking to try and score on 50 seconds. 55 maybe.
A magic number. Those of you who've been listening throughout the week and learning from the pearls of wisdom of Chris Ryan, as opposed to my pub quiz trivia.
There is one thing that doesn't take a rocket scientist to work out, and that is that Riley pretty much does what he wants out here, doesn't he? He is impressive to watch.
Nice inbound there, batted to bat. Riley looks up at the cube, sees how long is left. Australia have two timeouts left, so they may want to have the shot clock run down, but the game clock and the possession clock are reasonably similar. And someone needs an equipment change.
Chris Bond with the Australian colours on the front of his chair there.
I'm trying to see if it's Australian or Ukraine. It's not the deep green of the green and gold.
Maybe you can...
Either would work.
Maybe you couldn't quite get the shade of paint.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And true, and it's two. We're two blokes in the commentary box as well, and men are notoriously colourblind. So looking at that, it's green, it's blue, it's turquoise, it's what you call it.
That part of his chair that is painted is it's kind of like a metal plate, and people that have amputations below the knee, they have those plates to firstly stop their knees getting hit, and to also pin themselves in the chair, so every time they hit somebody, their body doesn't move anywhere and all the pressure goes through the other player's chair.
Bat battles his way through. Then inbounds, and there's 10 seconds for GB to get a last try, and with that excellent pass, leaves a lot for Smith to do. Gets it back. Hello, through the hands. That should count double. Highlight real stuff. You've even got Paul Shaw applauding there. Can Australia do something? It's tossed forward. That's more in hope than expectation. Well, it's another winning quarter for Australia. This time it was 15-12. GB at least very consistent, 12-12-12. But Australia 16-13-15. And the upshot of all that maths is that Australia lead by 8 tries, 44-36, as we go into the final break.
Fantastic last try, that, from GB. Aaron trusting his low pointer and Jack Smith. Put him under a little bit of pressure, maybe, but that's certainly a highlight play for Jack, and he'll be getting that one clipped.
All looking very calm there in the Australian camp. Equally calm as well on the GB side. So the loser here will go through into a position playoff on Saturday, and the four losers of the quarterfinals, so New Zealand, Canada, France, and the loser of this will play off. The winners of those matches, there'll be two matches. I'm not sure that they've been decided yet, but there will be two matches, and the winner of those will play off for fifth and sixth. The losers will play off for seventh and eighth. As we have a quick look at the statistics, zero turnovers for Australia, 3-4 Great Britain. It started to get a little harum-scarum at times for Team GB as they were desperately trying to get back into this match.
Yeah, and Australia being really, really relentless. You know, they're not really going weak with any of their lineups. They're keeping really, really their best guys out there and trying to get as much chemistry as possible, I think. They definitely are a force in this competition. They did lose to Japan yesterday, but I think a fully fit Briley, they can maybe live with them.
This was Briley Batt yesterday during the Japan match. He was having a lot of work done on his on the base of his neck, trying to loosen up the his left shoulder, but it doesn't seem to have affected him today.
No, and that tape, I've had injuries before where I've torn ligaments in my shoulder and tried to play. That tape really does help. It's almost acts as your ligaments. You know, it feels a lot more safe and secure, that shoulder. So although he's still obviously in some pain, it's probably in less danger.
You can trust it. It gives you a little bit more confidence. And
these physios know what they're doing.
They do. And yes, the entourages of the teams are getting bigger and bigger. There's nine on the Team GB staff that I've got listed in front of me, and there's probably more than that. As befits the exciting sport that wheelchair rugby is. So the pass goes astray as we see Ryan Cowling, who hasn't been very much in action so far this week. 46-year-old one-pointer.
Yeah, Ryan Cowling kind of lost the lineup that he used to play in. He had a really key role in the gold medal win in Tokyo. He was playing with either Stu Robinson, Aaron Phipps. Basically they used to play 3-5-3, 1.5, and he was the main guy.
Well, the ball was batted away there. It continued. He wasn't under control by Andrew Edmondson when he batted it away, so that it wasn't a change in possession. So the possession clock continued to tick down. Aaron Phipps saw that he wasn't going to be able to score with just 3 seconds to go, called for a timeout, hadn't got any left, and that results in a turnover. Riley Batt bounces it, as he has to. A great chest pass to Andrew Edmondson, who is hemmed in by Phipps and Mannion, and then presses the bat button.
That was a brilliant double team from Johnny Coggan and Ryan Cowling there to stop Riley. He tried to hop out of it twice, but they were too strong on that occasion.
Batt and Phipps side by side. Australia now with a 9-try lead. Phipps gets it to Mannion. The two high pointers combining very well indeed. Australia have got Josh Nicholson out there, as well as Andrew Edmondson. And Mick Ozan. Ozan on the ball now.
So So GB here trying to stop Australia getting back to the key. And they've managed to get back. And GB will have to try and score a key attack, which has been a downfall for them in this game. It's not looking great at the start here, but still 20 seconds left on the shot clock.
If anyone can pick a pass, it's going to be Aaron Phipps. Oh, he can barge his way through.
I think Riley thought he was going to pass it when he drew him out there. And
Lyde did as well, he sees. And Phipps obviously heard that and thought, ah, I've got them all fooled.
Johnny chasing Riley.
Yes, Aaron
Riley's
Phipps
was toying with him here.
Aaron Phipps was tied up by Josh Nicholson. Riley taking time off the clock. New South Welshman having a chat in the key. Phipps again, surely now he's going to pick a pass, and it pounces off Cowling, who wasn't expecting it. Andrew Edmondson certainly was expecting that pass.
Australia with some subs in the box.
Howe, Bond and Voris looking to come on.
Coach's timeout here for GB. So GB are going to make some subs as well.
Riley Batt coming off. Who'd have thought that? But Australia with a 10-point lead at the moment.
So they're just running through some, would have been great to have seen that.
Key
longer.
Defense, yeah.
Yeah, so I think they're running through a key attack there. We always work with O's being offense and the X's being the defense, so.
Come on, Chris, we need you to parse this for us.
This looks like a twin play, so. The two, they'll put two players around the person that's out of the key. The ball will go to the other side, and then those two players will kind of come in either side of the guy that's defending the middle of the key. So that will probably be Chris Bond. Call it a twin because it nullifies the chaser a little bit. But as you see, Australia are setting up in a different way to what was on the whiteboard. That all goes out the window and Aaron just flies through.
Best laid plans, and who cares if he can just go straight through the middle.
Something that's what Edmondson did there, he went to pass the ball and just by putting his hands up, the defence completely backs off. And we've seen quite a lot of that this week. People just doing that and it's allowed them to get over the try line or the halfway.
Faking to hand it off, the play action fake, for those of you who watch the NFL.
Particularly those guys with really good hand function. One of the Japanese players, one of the New Zealand players, they both do it really well.
Yes, Hayden Barton-Coutts, the 3.5er for New Zealand. Tall in the chair, the one who leads the haka as well. He gives a lot of fakes. There's a lot of, I think it's going to be give and go, but it's selling them a bit of candy.
Yeah.
Big bash there from Dickie Voris.
It's a really good, really quick thinking there from Andrew Edmondson. He knew he was straddling the halfway line, and as soon as he had that ball in control, he signed to the referee for a timeout.
In danger of over and back. So that's the penultimate timeout used by Australia. They are 10 points clear. They are in possession. Well, that one bounces off the noggin of Andrew Edmondson.
That's one of those. That's a quick fix for Australia. It was actually a good play. But either Chris has to hold off for half a second to pass that ball, or Edmondson needs to turn round earlier. So that's just a communication error there from Australia. Ollie did really well there. He was in a really tight position. Managed to feed the ball off to Aaron, who then passed it along to Nick Cummins. Had his first minutes of this game, I believe.
Yes, yes indeed. We've seen a fair bit of him throughout the week. Not a huge amount, but it's his first game time today. Ditto Dickie Voris there, the low pointer for Australia. Australia happy to take their time at the moment.
Andrew Edmondson riding through a lot of pressure there and managing to score the try. Good defense there from Chris Bond. Stopping Aaron scoring that quick goal. Nice composure there from Aaron Phipps and GB.
Edmondson, the great inbound to Bond.
All the Australia players in a cluster here. Aaron will be looking for this one.
We've got the wheels on Jake Howe, that's for sure. Now trying to get rid. Gets it to Edmondson and says, right, you deal with it. Edmondson finds himself wrapped up as well. And how about that?
The follow-up wasn't good enough there from GB when Aaron comes down to pressure that ball. All the other GB players need to get there as quick as they can and surround him as 1.5 players and one-pointers really struggle to get the ball off when they've got that much pressure on them. Get hit out of bounds. So he's been called for a pushing foul there, Andrew Edmondson. You have to break contact when you're pushing someone over a line. You can't just continually push them. I think that rule's in place to stop the really high pointers just basically pushing low pointers from miles
away.
Leaning
forward and easing them out. Mm. They have to bump into them.
That's unfortunate because you actually saw there on the replay that Chris Bond had gone out of bounds. Almost impossible for the referees to see. But with the hindsight of the replay.
Yes, the great camera work. Well, we get to see Ellis Hamiljack. 2.5 pointer. Played for the ACT Buccaneers. Errol Flynn was a Buccaneer. The Australian Capital Territory Buccaneers, who won the Division 2 title in the Australian Championship this year. 30 years old, one of the gliders. She won silver at the Commonwealth Games in basketball.
Yeah, she could be a really useful piece for Australia. You know, if she can continue to work in this team and get learn from the experience of Bat and Bond.
Yes, you got the two 2.5ers in Shea Graham and Ellis Hamiljack. She had a great tournament at the Australian Championship this year. Rather than playing for the Queensland Cyclones, where she wouldn't have got a whole lot of game time, and particularly with Zach Medel playing for the Queensland Cyclones. She went on loan, as it were, and played for the ACT Buccaneers, and that meant she got a lot more game time and was the one of the standout players in Division 2.
And those words, the playing time, they're so key for people coming through. Every minute's useful for those guys. She's got the ball here. Going to get harassed by Aaron Phipps.
Gets it away brilliantly in the end. She kept having to back off, made herself some room. And will go over the line.
Number one.
We're going to have to have a chat about our player of the match now.
Yeah, well, don't divulge anything. Maybe people are guessing at home and they want to wait until the presentation.
Ollie with a great pass to Nick Cummins. Has he got the strength to get over? Yes, he has.
Into the final minute of this final quarter-final. A lot of finality in that sentence. Ella Sabljak, though, she could quite happily play for another 10, 20 minutes, I reckon. Australia with the 10-point lead. And Phipps doesn't care about that, though. He does have a look at the cube.
They're not worrying, obviously, about last goals at this point. They're just trying to get as many chances to get turnovers as possible.
Yes, you may have seen the possession clock switch off there. Once it's below 40 seconds on the overall game clock, then it gets switched off. Ella Sabljak couldn't quite corral that one in. Gave her a little bit too much to do, did Chris Bond. And we're into the final 20 seconds. Well, GB have at least kept the deficit to single figures. I say that.
So we see that double there on the chaser from the, if you can remember back to when we saw the board from the coach.
Is this the twee play?
The tweet.
There we go, that's the code from here on in. It's the twee.
The renamed twee play.
Exactly, they're going to be holding up a board and shouting that. Twee! Well, it was almost yet another. It's always a turnover at the end of the period. And, oh, if that had been caught, it would have been a consolation try for Aaron Phipps. As it is, he's got plenty of them. But it's not gone the way of GB today. Australia win it 54-45. Australia cruise into the quarterfinals, where they will have a date with the host nation. That's going to be on prime time as well, you can guarantee that. Team GB, second best today in Australia. Well, maybe getting back to their very best.
Possibly one of the easiest decisions we've had to make, isn't it?
Easiest yet most difficult, because you don't want to give them all to Riley. And there is a point, I've said it before, I might have to approach him at the banquet at the end of the tournament and say, do you want me to take some of these home back to New South Wales? Because he's not going to be able to fit them all in his luggage. So I'll take a few. I'll volunteer to take a few back home for them. Ollie Mannion put in a good shift, particularly in the second quarter. Great to see Shea Graham. She got some time in the second quarter as well. Saw a little bit of Emily Miller. James McQuillan made a start. Jake Howe was on there as well. Pretty much everyone for Team GB got some game time as well.
Yeah, they did, and players that haven't played a team like Australia much, and you know, being able to play them, that's one of the most intense teams you can play, so they'll really have to you know, make use of those minutes and, you know, remember what they've learned for the future. See some dejected faces there from GB.
Well, GB, the highest they can finish now is fifth. And to do that, they're going to have to win a placement game that will be tomorrow, I think, on this main court, and then another one on Sunday. And they'll be very keen to rack up those wins, but you've got some big teams that lost in the quarterfinals. GB, France, Canada, New Zealand. How about that? That's a quad nations, that is. And that's purely playing for fifth place. That is the quality of this tournament.
Yeah, never have we had a 5-8, if you like, in the rankings be that strong.
I bet you're glad you're sitting alongside me and all you have to do is chat about it and listen to my trivia rather than thinking, good grief, we've got to come back and win two matches just to finish fifth.
Yeah, I mean, obviously less stress for me now, but, you know, still feel the emotions of the team, and you can see Jamie going around the huddle there just high-fiving everyone, I'm sure having some words, you know, hopefully of encouragement, and, you know, let's go get it tomorrow and kind of try and finish out this tournament strong.
12 turnovers for Great Britain. That's something they're going to have to eradicate if they are to make it through to the fifth and sixth place playoff. Australia, just the four turnovers in four quarters against Great Britain, the reigning Paralympic champions and number two in the world. That's a pretty fine achievement. These are the quarterfinals that we had today. Japan defeating New Zealand, cruising past them by 20 tries. USA always having just a little bit too much for Canada. Canada always just a step behind. Denmark winning it in overtime against France. Getting